Hi everyone. Today we're going to start talking about nuclear physics. Pretty exciting. But what is nuclear physics? Is it some highly advanced topic that only the greatest geniuses in the world can understand? No, silly. Nuclear physics is the study of matter, energy, and forces within the nucleus of an atom specifically. So we won't be talking about any energy, matter, or forces for larger objects, such as a car or a tree. We're going to get really, really zoomed in and just talk about what can happen inside of a nucleus. Let's start from the beginning. We need to discuss some fundamental properties of the universe so that we know where nuclear physics starts. One of the most fundamental properties of our universe is time. If you try to explain to someone what time is, you'd have a really difficult time doing it because time is so fundamental to our everyday experience. Fundamental just means that it's a common, basic thing that everyone already understands, so you don't really need to explain it, and if you try to, you'll find it's very difficult. Another example of a fundamental property of our universe is space, that is, three-dimensional space, as in the directions up, down, left, right, forward, and backward. Trying to explain space to someone would be challenging as well, because it's so fundamental to our everyday experiences. Another example of a fundamental property of our universe is mass. You probably learned about this in elementary school or middle school, and you might explain it to someone as how much stuff is inside of an object. And that's a pretty good definition. It's probably the easiest one on this list to define. But the fourth and most important property for us today is charge. Now, just like mass, if an object possesses this thing called charge, then it can generate forces with other objects that also have charge. There are three flavors of charge: positive, negative, and then technically the third is neutral, which means you have no charge at all. Now we could have used all kinds of words to describe these types of charge. Instead of positive and negative, we could have said up and down or left and right. Benjamin Franklin is credited with coming up with these names, positive and negative. And as a fun fact, it turned out a couple hundred years later, scientists figured out it probably would have been smarter to name them the other way around. Great job, Ben. Anyways, now that we've reviewed charge, let's ask this question. What is everything made of? Everything is made out of protons, which are positively charged, neutrons, which are neutrally charged, and electrons, which are negatively charged. These are typically referred to as the elementary particles, elementary meaning basic, and it means these are the smallest things that exist. Now, there are actually smaller things that we discovered after discovering the proton, neutron, and electron. Those are called quarks, but we're not going to talk about those today. You'd learn about those in a more advanced class. Protons, which are positively charged, have a specific amount of charge, referred to as the elementary charge. Again, elementary meaning basic, or the smallest amount of something you can have. The charge, or Q, of one proton is equal to one E. E stands for elementary charge. So in other words, a proton has the smallest amount of positive charge that is possible to exist in our universe. If you're curious what E is equal to, it's 1.6 times 10 to the negative 19 coulombs. That's a really, really small amount of coulombs, so it's a tiny charge. A neutron does not have any charge at all because it's neutral. So Q, or charge, for a neutron equals 0 E, or 0 coulombs. And finally, the exact charge of an electron could be described as negative 1 E, which means it's the elementary charge times negative 1. In coulombs, this would be negative 1.6 times 10 to the negative 19 coulombs. If you look at the charge of a proton and an electron, they have exactly the same amount of charge, but with different signs. Protons are positive and electrons are negative, but the amount of charge is the same. So looking back up to the top of this slide, when I asked what is everything made of, I really meant everything. Everything in the entire universe, from tiny electrons to massive galaxies, are made out of these three elementary particles and nothing else. Anytime you've looked at a beautiful landscape, the water, mountains, trees, air, clouds, all of those are just different arrangements of protons, neutrons, and electrons. Every time you've eaten some delicious food, no matter what kind of food it was, you were eating protons, neutrons, and electrons. And in fact, every single person who you will ever meet in your entire life is made only from protons, neutrons, and electrons. So therefore, understanding these three elementary particles and how they behave and interact with one another is going to be key to understanding how the universe is put together. So, how are they put together? Well, they're put together in a structure known as an atom. You've probably learned about these before. An atom is composed of a nucleus, which is going to be the thing we discuss the most in this unit because it's called nuclear physics, as in referring to the nucleus. and that's composed of positively charged protons and neutrons all stuck together in a small space in the core of the atom. Buzzing around the nucleus are the electrons, which travel independently of each other. Now, this depiction of an atom is a little bit out of date. We now understand that electrons move about in something called the electron cloud, where you can calculate the probability of where an electron is likely to be, but you never know exactly where its position is. Now, you might be wondering what holds this atom together. It looks a lot like a solar system, where planets are orbiting around a sun. But a planet would orbit a star because of gravity, and atoms are really, really small, way too small to generate strong gravitational forces. So what's the deal? Why does this stay together? Well, there's actually two reasons, and they have to do with the fundamental forces in our universe. That is, forces that have existed since the beginning of time that cause literally every event in the universe to occur. The first fundamental force we'll discuss is gravitation, which says that any two objects that both possess some amount of matter will attract and get pulled towards one another. The second fundamental force is called electromagnetism, and it says that opposite charges and poles will attract one another, while like charges and poles will push each other apart and repel. The third fundamental force is called the strong nuclear force. This force only occurs at very short distances between protons and neutrons, and it pulls them towards each other very, very strongly, hence the name. And the final fundamental force is called the weak nuclear force, which is actually quite complicated and not the kind of thing you need to understand until you take college courses on quantum physics. So that'll probably be fun, but let's not deal with it for now. Two out of these four fundamental forces explain why atoms stay together. The one you probably could have guessed was electromagnetism, which holds positively charged protons and negatively charged electrons together. That's why the electrons orbit the positively charged nucleus. But the one you probably didn't know is in the bottom left. The strong nuclear force is what holds the nucleus itself together. It turns out that protons and neutrons are glued together by the strong nuclear force. So strong nuclear is what we have to thank for stable nuclei. Okay, let's get a little more specific. What is the net charge of this atom? We have a diagram on the right of a few protons and a few neutrons all stuck together in the nucleus of an atom, and then two electrons orbiting on the outside. And we're being asked, what is the net charge? Well, we know what charge means, but what does net mean? Net means if you grabbed everything all in one big net, how much would you have? So it's kind of like total. So we're really being asked, what is the total charge of this atom? All right, let's do some math. We have 8 positively charged protons. So we're gonna say that those each contribute a charge of 1, positive 1. There are 6 neutrons, which contribute no charge at all because they are neutral. And we have 2 negatively charged electrons. So we'll say that each of them contributes a charge of negative 1. Now we're really simplifying the way we talk about charge here. We're not using units like coulombs or anything like that. We're gonna really simplify here. So 8 times 1 is 8, 6 times 0 is 0, and 2 times negative 1 is negative 2. So we're really just adding 8, 0, and negative 2. So our answer is 6. So you would say that the net charge of this atom is 6. Why did I ask this question? I asked you about the charge of this atom because there's a special word that you need to know when you start a unit like nuclear physics. The word is ion. This atom we just determined is an example of an ion. That is, an atom that has a charge. If the charge of this atom had been 0 and it was uncharged, then this atom would not have been an ion. But it has a charge of positive 6, so it is an ion. So ions mean atoms that do have a charge of any kind. Okay, so this atom is an ion, but how did it become an ion? Why isn't it neutral? Well, a neutral atom can become an ion, aka a charged atom, by doing one of two things. They can either gain electrons, which would make them negatively charged because they've just taken on extra negative things, or, like in the diagram below, you can become an ion if you lose electrons. Losing negatively charged electrons means your charge will become more positive. So that would make a positively charged ion. Now you only need to call it an ion. You don't have to worry about whether it's negative or positive necessarily for naming purposes, but you should eventually be able to keep track of what the charge of an ion is. Is it +2? Is it -6? And if you can go that far, you're pretty much good for ions. Okay, so we got that concept. What's next? We're being given a diagram with a proton in the middle and 2 negatively charged electrons on the outside. And we're asked, what is the full name of this atom? I don't know, Brian Johnson? Probably not. Here's the answer. It's hydrogen 1. All right, now before I tell you why this is the name of this atom, I'm actually going to change the atom and then tell you its new name, and I want you to see if progressively you can figure out the pattern for how naming occurs for atoms. Let's say that I add a neutron into the nucleus. What is the name of this atom now? It's hydrogen 2. Okay, let's say that I add another proton. This is now called helium 3. Add another neutron. Now it's helium 4. Add another neutron, helium 5. Do you have the pattern yet? Let's do two more. Add another proton, lithium 6. And finally, we'll add one more proton, and we have beryllium 7. Did you figure out the pattern? The number on the end was how many protons plus neutrons there were inside the nucleus. And the amount of protons, that is just the blue guys, that determined the name out front. That was the difference between hydrogen, helium, lithium, and beryllium. Now you weren't really able to guess what these front names were. These are element names that we'll talk about in a couple minutes, but you probably could have figured out the number. Here's a concept that's new for us, isotopes. You can see I've highlighted helium 3, helium 4, and helium 5, and I'm categorizing those as isotopes of one another. Isotopes are kind of like cousins, where they're all related to each other, but they're not quite the same. Here's the definition. Isotopes are different versions of the same atom with different amounts of neutrons. Helium 3, you might recall, had two protons. Helium 4 also had two protons. Helium 5 also had two protons. But they all had different amounts of neutrons added on, and that changed the number at the end. All of them will behave very similarly to each other, but helium 5 is the heaviest, and helium 3 is the lightest, and that will change its behavior slightly, but they're all going to act like helium. You'll learn more about this in chemistry next year, but for now, just know that isotopes are kind of like cousin atoms, where they behave mostly the same, but a little bit different from each other. So here's a nice big diagram of a bigger atom than one we've seen before, and we should now be able to answer these three questions. What is the net charge of this atom? Is it an ion, or is it not an ion? And what is the name of the element that we're looking at, as in hydrogen, helium, etc.? All right, first question, what is the net charge of this atom? Here's my math. I count 8 positively charged protons, so I'll say 8 times positive 1. I also count 8 neutral neutrons, so 8 times 0, that's easy. I can kind of ignore that step if I want to. And then there are 8 negatively charged electrons on the outside. So I end up doing 8 plus 0 plus negative 8, so my answer is 0. So what is the net charge? It is zero charge, or you could also say neutral. So is this an ion, or is it not an ion? Well, remember, an ion is an atom that has charge. So if the charge is zero, then this is clearly not an ion. And finally, what is the element name that we're looking at? Is it hydrogen? Is it helium? Is it beryllium? Well, no, it's actually oxygen. And if you didn't get that answer, don't be too hard on yourself, because it was kind of a trick question. You couldn't really get it unless you know your chemistry. If you did get this answer, then it's likely you've looked at one of these before. This is an example of something called the periodic table of elements. In your chemistry class, you'll use this pretty much every single day to help you solve problems and find answers to questions. The periodic table of elements is a list of all known types of matter in the universe. We're fairly confident that across the universe, it's these exact types of matter that exist everywhere, and any that we haven't discovered are simply so large that it requires a lot of energy to generate them. So it's likely that the universe is made out of just these things. So what are some examples of things that are on the periodic table of elements? Well, there's hydrogen, which is the most basic form of matter in the universe and the type of matter that existed for billions of years before we had things like stars and planets. There's helium, which is the stuff you fill up balloons with to make them float. There's copper and gold, which are both metals that are good conductors of electricity. And there's mercury, which is a metallic liquid, and uranium, which is a famous radioactive substance. In the top left corner of each square on the periodic table, you'll find the element's atomic number. For example, the atomic number for hydrogen is 1. This number refers to the amount of protons in this element. The next thing you'll find in the square is a capital letter, sometimes with a lowercase letter next to it, which is called the symbol for the element. For example, hydrogen's symbol is capital H, whereas helium's symbol is capital H with a lowercase e. Interestingly, some of these symbols do not resemble the English word, such as gold, which is AU. Au is short for aurum, which is the Latin word for gold. Underneath the symbol is the name of the element. That's the easy part. That's the part you'll recognize. And on the bottom is the most complicated number that you'll have to deal with. It's called the atomic mass, and it's actually a combination of two numbers. It's the amount of protons in the nucleus of this atom, and on top of that, we add to this the average amount of neutrons that this element tends to have. So it ends up being a decimal. We don't need to worry about that too much for now, just know it's protons plus neutrons, and it's called atomic mass. If you want to find this information about any element, all you have to do is look at a periodic table. And if you go to www.ptable.com, you can find what's called the interactive periodic table, where you can learn more details than just these four things about any element you want. It's pretty cool. Check it out. So here's our final question for today. And now that we've learned all this stuff, we should be able to answer all these questions pretty confidently. First, as we look at this atom on the right, we could ask, what is its atomic number? Reminder that atomic number means the amount of protons. Looking at the diagram, I count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 protons. So the atomic number of this atom is 7. The next question asks, what is the mass number? Mass number for an atom means how many protons plus neutrons are there? Well, we already counted that there's 7 protons, so let's count the neutrons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So 7 protons plus 7 neutrons means the mass number is 14. Here's the million-dollar question. What is the specific name of the atom that we're currently looking at? The full name, meaning the word that describes the element that we're looking at, and the number that goes on the end. Do you remember this from earlier in the video? Well, the name is the element. So on the periodic table, we'd have to look for something that has 7 protons. And the number at the end is how many things are in the nucleus. So that's protons plus neutrons. So the element name would be nitrogen, and you would only know that if you actually looked at the periodic table. And the number on the end would be 14. So the answer is nitrogen 14. All right, that's a pretty good introduction to nuclear physics. I hope you enjoyed, and I'll see you in the next video.